Welcome to another video on imaging in nuclear medicine. Today we will talk about image reconstruction and in particular about the maximum likelihood approach. As an introduction, remember that in one of the previous videos I told you that the problem that we have to solve in image reconstruction when we want to reconstruct from projection data was actually solved already a long time ago by the mathematician shown here in the middle, Johann Radon. So he could show that if you have measured the Radon transform or parallel projections of your object of interest, you can use an analytical algorithm called FBP or filtered back projection to reconstruct the 2D or 3D tomographic image from the measured projections. But if you have a look at all modern PET and SPECT scanners, none of those scanners is using FPP as default reconstruction method. And that has several reasons. One of the reasons is that FPP doesn't handle the high noise on the data that we acquire in nuclear medicine very well. Second reason is that in FPP you assume that the measured data is the exact line integral of your object, and as we will see in one of the following videos, this is not exactly true for PET and SPECT imaging. So it's the line integral is a reasonable approximation for what we measure, but it's not completely true. It's a bit more complicated. And the third reason is that actually for filtered back projection, you need complete sampling. So what does that mean? So if you think of a PET scanner, we would need a perfect ring with many small crystals. But if you have a look at real PET scanners nowadays, they're usually not a ring, but rather a polygon made out of flat detector panels, so to say. And between those panels usually have small gaps. So that means in all of the views, you have missing projection lines. And taking care of those in filtered back projection is complicated. And if you don't do that, you get very interesting artifacts. So before I will explain what we usually do instead, let's have a look at a short motivating academic toy example. So it's actually one of the easiest reconstruction problems that you can consider. So let's say we have an image with only two pixels or voxels, so voxel 1 with an unknown activity concentration lambda 1 and voxel 2 with an unknown activity concentration lambda 2. And we have a very simplistic PET scanner that has three detector pairs, so the blue one, and I call that line of response 1. We have the pink one or the purple one, which is LOR2, and the green one, which is LOR3. And since we know the acquisition physics very well, we can perfectly describe the system in terms of equations. So that means if we know the activity concentration in voxel 1 and 2, we can perfectly describe the expectation or the expected measurements on the three LORs. So in this example that I've chosen here, for example, we know that on LOR1, or LOR1 is only sensitive to the first voxel. So we know that the expected measured value on LOR1 is a constant, so I call it alpha times lambda 1. The same for LOR2, but LOR2 is only sensitive to activity in voxel 2. And LOR3 actually sees or gets contributions from both voxels, lambda 1 and lambda 2, and I call a sensitivity factor here beta. So we can rewrite those three equations also in terms of a matrix. So first of all, what I do is I put the unknowns that we want to reconstruct, so lambda 1, lambda 2, into a one-dimensional vector, right? So that has two elements. And I also put the LORs or the measurements or the expectation of the measurements also in a one-dimensional vector that has then three elements. And then we can formulate the so-called system matrix that maps the activity concentrations in the voxels to the expected measurements. And if you do that, you get that system matrix. You have alpha, 0, 0, alpha, and beta, beta. So it's a 3 times 2 matrix in this case. Of course, in real life, we not only have 2 voxels. If you do 3D image reconstruction, we have around 1 million voxels and approximately 1 billion measurements. So that matrix actually gets huge. And usually you don't store that even in memory, so you compute it on the fly. So in a more formal way, we could say that the expected measurement on a given LORI is a summation over all voxels, and we have those system matrix elements Cij that describe the contribution from activity in a given voxel to LORI. Now the question is, let's say we have done measurements, so we have activity in both voxels and we acquire data for a certain amount of time. And let's say we measure Y1, Y2, Y3 counts on the 3 LORs respectively. So how do we reconstruct the activity concentration in the 2 voxels? So one way to treat the problem is actually to see it as an optimization problem. So we could say we aim to maximize the likelihood of the reconstructed image given the measured data. So I've written that down here. So we have the likelihood of our reconstructed image lambda, so that's the long 1D vector, given all the measured data y, also long 1D vector. And computing that term is very complicated, but if you remember the Bayes theorem about conditional probability, you can actually rewrite the term, which is shown here on the right. So this is the same as the likelihood of the measured data given the image times the likelihood of the image divided by the likelihood of the data. Now, since we aim to maximize that function, what we can do is we can also take the log of that function, because the log is a monotonic function, so it doesn't change the position of the maximum. So if I take the log of that expression, of course, you see then get also the logs of the likelihoods, but of course the product is turned into a sum actually. And what you can also see is, since we will take the maximum with respect to lambda, we can actually see that this last term here doesn't depend on lambda, but only on the measured data. So it's a constant. So we can just write it as a constant. So if you remember in one of my previous videos where we talked about the statistics of photon counting, we could see that actually in PET and SPECT, the measured data follows the Poisson distribution with a very, very good approximation. And that means we can actually calculate that term here. So the likelihood, or the log likelihood of the data given an image. And this term is shown here. So if you expect Y bar measurements on an LORI, the log likelihood is the sum over all LORs from, let's say, 1 to M of minus Yi bar plus Yi, so this is the actual measurement, times the log of Yi bar. And Yi bar, as I said, is the expected measurement given an image lambda. And this is actually described here in our forward model. So it's, again, it's the system matrix times the image plus contaminations. So again, to compute it, you need to know the acquisition physics of your system. But in this video, we will just assume that we know. So we know how to, we know that. So we know how to compute those Cij factors. In real life, you always have those contaminations. In SPECT imaging, those are scattered events. And in PET imaging, we have scattered events and random events. But that will be also explained in a later video. Okay, but still, the problem, of course, is hard to solve because we know how to compute that term. But we don't know how to compute that term here, so the likelihood of the image. And if you think about it, calculating the likelihood of an image is actually a very complicated problem. So what we can do instead is we can just say, okay, let's for a second assume that all possible solutions, so all possible images, have the same likelihood. That's the same as saying L of lambda equals 1. So for all lambdas, for all vector lambdas, it's always 1. And equivalently, that means, of course, that log L of lambda is 0. So that means that term vanishes. And that means that the log likelihood of the of lambda given of the reconstructed image given the measured data is the same as the log likelihood of the measured data given lambda minus or plus a constant. And I just have inserted that term here that we just calculated on the last slide. Okay, and then we can say, okay, now we're just looking for the image that maximizes that likelihood. So in other words, that is the image that explains the measured data the best. So as a short side note or spoiler, this is usually not the solution that you want for diagnostic purposes, but that will be explained in the next video. So to find the maximum likelihood solution or the maximum likelihood reconstruction, what we have to do is we have to maximize that function shown here. Or in other words, yeah, the maximum likelihood image is the argmax of that function here. So it's the log Poisson likelihood. And that depends, of course, on your forward model, which I've just written again here on the right side. And if you remember your courses on analysis, the necessary condition in the optimal point is, of course, that all partial derivatives with respect to all variables, so to all lambda j's, so that's the activity in every voxel, vanishes. That means we get many equations. So if you have n unknowns or n voxels, we get n equations. So remember, in real life, n is usually a million. So we have a million equations. And every equation or every partial derivative has to be zero. And if you calculate actually partial derivative, the partial derivatives of that function here, that is not very complicated. So we just, it's a bit of basic math. You have to use the chain rule, of course. Then you will find this expression here. So it's the sum over all measurements from 1 to m of Cij times minus 1 plus the measured data in bin I divided by basically the expected data. And the expected data is the sum of all the voxels Cij times lambda j plus the contaminations. So as I told you, it's basically we have a million equations of a million unknowns. And unfortunately, you can see that those equations are also nonlinear in lambda. So it's very complicated to analytically solve that equation. So I think in many cases, actually, there is no direct analytical solution to it. But we will see in the next video how you can actually maximize that function. In this video, I will come back to our academic toy example where we have we only had two voxels, three measurements, and a very simple system matrix shown here again. And in this example, we can actually solve, or you can find the maximum likelihood solution analytically. So all we have to do is we have to set all the partial derivatives that are shown here to zero. And I can do that, of course, for our two voxels. So for two voxels, we get two partial derivatives. If you insert everything for the first voxel, you get that equation. And for the second voxel, you get this equation. We have two equations, two unknowns. And in this case, actually, we can solve it. So first of all, for example, you can just subtract the equations. Then you can see that this term and this term, they will cancel out. And from the comparison of these terms, you will find that y1 divided by lambda 1 equals y1 divided by lambda 2, or in other words, lambda 2 equals lambda 1 times y1, y2 divided by y1. And then you can just insert that in any of the equations and solve for the other unknown. And if you do that, you will actually find that the maximum likelihood solution for lambda 1 or lambda 2 equals y1 or y2 times 1 plus y3 divided by 1, y1 plus y2 divided by alpha plus beta. So again, I would like to stress that The analytic solution here is only possible because this is a simplistic toy example. So in real life, where we have millions of lambdas and billions of measured bins, basically, it's not possible to find the solution analytically. So we have to do iterative techniques to solve that problem. And we will talk about that in the next video.